don't have to listen for my name. They don't have to walk me down the aisle. I just wanna make you proud. Should I make the Hall of Fame? Or they save a special seat? I just hope that you'll be pleased. You covered me in the midst of it all. You loved me, gave me another chance. You rescued me. I was gonna fall. You saved me. So in my life,
Be glorified.
Yeah.
Be glorified.
You get the glory. You get the praise. You take the honor. I just want to say,
praise.
You get the glory.
You get the glory.
You get the praise.
You get the praise.
Take all of the honor.
You take the honor.
I just want to say,
praise.
You get the glory.
You get the glory.
I want you to get the praise.
You get the praise.
You take the honor.
You take the honor.
I just want to say,
get the glory.
You get the glory. Father, you get the praise.
You get the praise.
You take the honor.
Take the honor.
I just want to say, I've come back to say,
Hallelujah. 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 If you could just stand to your feet so we could just give God the honor, the glory, and the praise for being present here today. Can we just give him a praise? For some of us, it could have been a press to get here, but we made it here, and we just want to thank you, Father, for allowing us to be present. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the abundance of blessings in this house. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for this day. We thank you, Lord Jesus. This is our first service here today. today, Father God. Father God, I thank you, Lord Jesus, for every single vessel that is present in this house today, Lord Jesus. I pray, Father God, that you would cover them, Lord. They're already covered, Lord, because they're in your house, Lord. We thank you for even preparing the way, for opening up the floodgates of heaven, Lord, and showering us with your presence. We thank you, Father God, for your fire, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for dispatching your heavenly warring angels to surround each and every one of us. We thank you that we're covered by the blood. We thank you that we're covered by your divine protection and fire, Lord Jesus. We ask, Lord Jesus, right now, Lord, that you would touch every heart, touch every vessel, removing any weights, anything that is not like you, Lord. We leave it at your feet right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. Let us be free to worship you and praise you, Father God, with all of our heart, Lord. We break and we remove every assignment of distraction right now in the name of Jesus. I pray, Father God, that when everybody leave here, they leave feeling filled. Not just today when they leave out of here, but throughout the week forever, Lord, that they will feel a fire like never before. They will feel your zeal and your spark and your fire, Father God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for dying and resurrecting. Dying and resurrecting on the cross for all of our sin. We thank you for sparing our life. Some of us could have died or could have been on our deathbed. But we thank you, Lord, that you gave us another day. We thank you, Lord Jesus. I ask, Lord, that you would even touch the children, Lord. Touch them, Lord. Cover them with your blood and your divine protection, Lord. I pray that you would have your way in this place. Have your way in this place, Lord. Touching everyone, allowing everybody to be free to worship you in spirit and in truth, Lord Jesus. I pray, Lord Jesus, that you will bless every speaker. Bless the worship team. Bless the apostles that's going to come forth and speak. Bless the pastor that's going to come forth and speak. Bless the children's church and the children's ministry as well. And I pray that everyone that's trying to make it here to find the building, Lord, that they will know right where to go, Lord Jesus. And I pray, Father God, that your fire and your praise and your glory will fall afresh on them, that they will want to know more about you, Lord. So, Father God, we seal this prayer in your name, Lord, giving you all the honor and the praise and the glory that you're so deserving of. And I pray that y'all would just have a freedom to worship the Father, y'all, because he's so good. Like, we woke up this morning. Somebody didn't make it to get up this morning. Somebody don't have shelter. They don't know where they're going to go. They don't know where they're going to get the next meal. But I praise God because he's such a good father. He's such a good father, y'all. He's so deserving of our praise. We don't even realize it. Sometimes we think we gotta come to God so perfect, like we got it all together. But he said, come as you are. Come as you are. So I just praise God because he's such a good father. He walks with us when we feel like we ain't got nobody to walk with us. He walks with us. He walks behind us. He protects us. He covers us. Ain't nobody better than nobody. Nobody is better than nobody. We are all one flesh in the spirit. So help us, Father God. Help us, Lord, to be able to love like you love. Help us to see people through the lenses of your eyes, even when we're done wrong. Help us to see people through the lenses of your eyes. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for loving us, giving us chance after chance to get it right and get it together. Thank you so much for your grace, your mercy, your love, your compassion, your joy. Thank you so much. We thank you, Father. And we just pray, Lord, that you would have your way. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Come on. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Yes.
I don't think y'all know how special today is.
How special is it, G?
I don't think y'all know how special today is. Today, God is good, y'all. God is good.
Yes.
Who got it? Let's welcome some people. Come on, Coolies. Come on, give a welcome, Coolies.
What's good, y'all? God bless y'all this morning. We would like to welcome everybody to the Soul Church. For those who don't know what Soul means, it's S-O-L and it's short for School of Light Church.
We would also like to welcome all of our online viewers.
Woo, woo, woo. Shout out to you if you're watching online. But anyway, listen, it's a blessing to see all the faces. We hope that y'all, you know, maybe come after this Sunday. Y'all know how it be that one time a year. But we pray in Jesus' name that seriously, that God would do a work in you because God is very faithful. And the doors is always open and you're always welcome to come here. So God bless you on this morning.
God bless you guys.
Amen. Now, let me tell y'all.
Hallelujah.
Y'all don't know how special today is.
Amen.
Today, April 4th, 2000.
Hold on. First today, can we rejoice in the Lord? It is Resurrection Day.
I know. I'm excited.
Amen. So first. Just so you got, for you don't know
who we are, I'm right? Sorry, y'all.
I'm a Apostle Moses, and this is my beautiful wife, Regina. Amen.
Yes, Lord.
We the senior visionaries of this ministry, and first we want to celebrate Jesus Christ. Amen. This is the day that
Yes, Lord. We
celebrate that he rose from the grave. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Can y'all get it? Hold on. We got to give a better clap of praise for Jesus. Amen. If you know Jesus saved you from some stuff, preserved you from some stuff, had grace and mercy on you when you didn't deserve it. If you know you only here because of the goodness and mercy of Jesus. Come on. It's only because of Jesus that we're here today. Amen. 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 So we want to give him the honor that's due unto him. But it's so amazing how Jesus, he the master orchestrator. And my wife had to remind me of this, how perfect God is. We've been believing God for a bigger space, and it seemed like already we're going to have to believe God for a bigger space. Amen. That's all right. You know, we've been believing God for a bigger space, and we've been seeking and searching, and Brother Kenny and Apostle Christian, we've been looking and looking. And we found some decent spots, and it just will always be something. And we're so grateful that God brought us here. Amen? Amen. We're so grateful that God brought us into this new space. But it's been a journey. And sometimes it was frustrating. Sometimes it was hard. Sometimes we was like, God, when are you going to do it? Amen. But it's amazing that God is the master orchestrator. Don't share your part?
Don't you share my part.
Okay, I'll let you share your part. You want to share? I'm going to let you share. Go ahead and share.
Go ahead and say that again. God is the master
orchestrator. God is the master orchestrator.
That's your part. Y'all, look it up. April 4th, 2015. It was a Saturday when we first started Royal Cloth Ministries. Today is our 6-year anniversary of Royal Cloth Ministries.
Listen. Listen, it's nobody but God can orchestrate it like that.
We had no idea until the middle of the night that this was actually our anniversary.
Literally. Today is the exact day, April 4th, that we started Royal Cloth Ministry 6 years ago. Our first day in the new building on Resurrection Sunday, the exact day anniversary of the ministry. Come on, somebody better listen. Won't God do it? I said, won't he do it? Some of y'all waiting on God to do some things for you. So be encouraged. Like, God proved that not only is he the master orchestrator, but he's the God of his word. That his promises is yes and amen. So if you holding on and you believe in God for something, just keep on holding on a little bit longer. God is faithful to bring it to pass in your life. God is faithful to honor every word that he spoke to you. Every single one. And sometimes when you feel like, God, it need to come now, sometimes God hold back just a little bit because he want to bring it together so beautifully.
It took 6 years to get back to the date.
6 years to get back.
6 years.
So we just want to give God the glory. We thank you that everyone is here to honor this special day with us. Resurrection Sunday, first day in the building. Anniversary of Royal Cloth, the beginning of all things new. Hallelujah. Amen. I don't even know how I'm holding. I ain't want to talk today because I'm holding back. I have tears in the eyes. But listen, some of y'all new to the family, and we praise God for y'all. This has been a six-year journey. From being in a living room this size is this square. All of us packed in, waiting to see what God to do. And then we went to the Coolies, and then we went to Cherry Hill, and then Apostle Christian was gracious enough to share his space with us. And God is just upgrading us. Season by season, year by year, God is upgrading us. You know what he proven to us? That this ministry is in his hands and nothing can stop it. Nothing can deter it. Nothing can pluck us out of his hands. Nothing and nobody can stop it or pluck it out of his hands. Amen? Is that all right? Amen. Amen. You saw how much you want to say? Amen. I'm going to sit myself down. We're going to get ready for the worship.
Hallelujah. Giving glory. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Listen, y'all look good. Y'all look good. Thank you. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
I got it. All right.
She got it in the name of Jesus.
Come on and clap your hands with me. Come on and clap your hands with me. Come on and clap your hands with me. Come on and clap your hands with me.
We sing, we sing, we sing hallelujah. Sing it louder, sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah. Come on, sing hallelujah. I need y'all to stand up. Come on, come on and clap
your hands with me.
We clap into the King.
Clap your hands with me.
Clap, clap.
Come on and clap your hands with me. Come on and clap your hands with me.
We sing, we sing, we sing hallelujah. One more time.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Let me hear y'all sing.
Hallelujah.
Bring it up from your belly. Sing
hallelujah.
Clap, clap. Come on.
Hallelujah.
Take it round. Sing
hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Y'all sound good.
Clap your hands if you really love Jesus. Clap your hands if you really love Christ. Clap your hands if you really love Jesus. Clap your hands if you really love Christ. Jump for joy. 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 Jump for joy.
Hey,
jump for joy. Jump for joy. Clap your hands if you really love Jesus. Clap your hands if you really love Christ. Clap your hands if you really love Jesus. Clap your hands if you really love Christ. Jump for joy.
Hey, jump for joy.
Hey, jump for joy.
Hey,
jump for joy. Jump for joy. Jump for joy. Jump for joy. Hallelujah.
Hey, hey, hey.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Woo! Hallelujah.
Let us sing unto the Lord. Praise God.
Hallelujah. All right, media.
Put it on. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can it come up some?
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We're standing here because of you today, God. We're standing here because of you.
Yes,
and you made a way, God, so we thank you, Lord.
You're my Redeemer.
pour it out, pour it out, pour it out. Pour it out, pour it out, pour it out.
We pour out our praise, pour out our praise.
Pour it out, pour it out, pour it out. Pour it out, pour it out, pour it out. Pour it out, pour it out, pour it out.
We pour out our praise,
we pour out our praise.
Down. down before you. Yeah, we bow down. We bow down. We bow down. Yeah, we bow down before you.
Hallelujah, God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, God. Thank you, God. We bow down, God. We bow down, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Yes. You are Alpha and Omega. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised. You
what a sweet worship. We don't like to rush the Holy Spirit, amen, when it's working in the midst of us, in the midst of our hearts, working. Because at the same time that you're worshiping, God is communicating with you. He's telling you the deep depths of your heart, amen. He's revealing some things to you. He's answering some questions. He's reminding you of some folks, amen, that you need to forgive. He's doing a mighty work on you as you worship. As long as you have ears to hear, right? Worship allows us to be free with God, to be ourselves, you know. Sometimes we look around and we're trying to, you know, figure out who's worshiping, who's not. But you can worship in the deep depths of your heart. You can close your eyes and you won't see nobody, I promise you. If you just close your eyes, you won't even see nobody. Amen? You can try that, just to close your eyes and focus on God so he can speak to you and so you can speak to him. Because while you're looking around, you ain't talking to him. You're just looking. So we can try that next time, amen. We can try that during even the word when the word is going forth. You can try to just close your eyes for a moment and just say, God, what do you have to say? Let me be open to receive the word. God is going to speak to you today. He's already speaking. Amen. You guys comfortable? Y'all good? Y'all looking so uptight. Some of y'all looking real uptight back there. Come on now. Loosen up now. It's not so serious. It's not so serious because God is good and he's good all the time. He's not like this one on the throne ready to bash you with his hammer. Amen. So you guys loosen up. Have some fun. You're amongst family. I promise you, you are in a safe place. I promise you that. I've been in this place for a long time, a couple of years, amen? And I feel safe, all right? When I always felt unsafe all my life. And it wasn't until I came into this ministry that I felt safe. Amen. So if you're in an unsafe place, I'm telling you, it's safe here. It's safe here, okay? And if it's not, you come see me if you feel a type of way. You come talk to me. Have a conversation with me, amen? Amen. Say, listen, you lied to me. You told me it was safe and it wasn't safe. Just come see me. We can have a conversation in the closet, amen? Amen. All right, in a ladies' room somewhere. Gee, you got something to say? I'm sorry.
Amen.
This is my sister. Hallelujah. This
y'all,
is my
sister. We've been
sister.
Doing this for a long time.
I love you.
I love you.
Now, let's not get out the spirit of worship.
Okay. Amen.
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 Because it's offering time.
Amen. Come on, you ready
it's
to offer
it
up?
It's offering time. Do we got baskets, y'all? Where are baskets? Okay, so the Cash App.
The Cash App.
Is $ School of Light.
School of Light.
You got it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Amen.
Amen.
Right. You go. I already talked. No, I talked the whole time.
I talked too.
No.
Amen. I am a cheerful giver. All grace abounds toward me. I have sufficiency in all things. I receive seed because I am a sower. I receive bread for food. You are multiplying seed that was sown. And you are increasing my righteousness. I declare my family is blessed.
Come on now.
I declare my finances are blessed.
Come on now.
My relationships are blessed.
Hold on.
Go ahead, play that. Yeah.
I declare my family is blessed.
Okay.
I declare that my finances are blessed.
Come on now.
I declare that my relationships are blessed.
Yes.
Y'all, my ministry is blessed.
Yes.
And I declare that my businesses is blessed.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Amen.
In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. So I believe the Cash App was
praise
dollar
God.
Sign School of Light. Amen.
The Cash App is dollar sign School of Light. We are still taking pledges as well, family. And that Cash App is dollar sign pledge.
Pledge soul.
Soul. Amen. That again is dollar sign pledge soul. We are excited about the things that God has done for us as a family. We have witnessed God's blessing over our life. And I'm going to say something. You know, a couple weeks ago I shared when I did the tithing that if you didn't have money to give of your time. Now, the family here, we gave money, you know, to be able to be in this place. But what I saw was the family give their time. They sacrifice. They come here after work. You know, work. You just want to go home and lay in the bed, right? And cook dinner for your family. Well, some of us, you know, sometimes I don't like doing that. But I watched this beautiful, amazing family come together as one.
and sacrifice their time to put together this building so that we can have a place to come and worship. And in that, I saw this beautiful love. You know, there was just this love we've endured. We endured being in a place where we could barely put our hands up without smacking the neighbor next to us, right? We endured the race to be here today. So for that, come we on. Give God the glory. So let's give
Hallelujah.
God a shout out for what he's done for us. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Thanking God for the sacrifice, the endurance to be able to make that sacrifice and to be able to stand here today. You know, it's a little hot. Remember, we were cold earlier. The glory, the fire fell on us. Praise God. Amen. We thank you. God loves a cheerful giver. So I'm going to pray over the offering. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for the sacrifices of those that gave, God. We thank you for this beautiful home, God. God, we just thank you. You're so awesome and you're so amazing. God, I pray that you will bless those that didn't have to give today, God. God, we thank you and we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you all for giving. I would like to say thank you to everybody who pledged and gave some money so we can get up in this place, y'all. We appreciate y'all sacrifices. We appreciate y'all faith to go forward in Jesus' name. Apostle?
Amen, amen. So I just wanted to quickly just give some honors out. Obviously, I honor all my visitors. Thank you guys for coming out and celebrating with us today. Having service with us. Amen. Give a hand clap for our visitors. It's a lot of y'all, so I ain't going to put y'all on the spot today. I usually put you on the spot. Some of y'all right in the front. You be a prime person. Be like, bro, stand up. What's your name? We're going to let you live today. Amen. We're going to get your name afterwards. God bless you. I'm Moses, man. God bless you, bro. I also want to say I want to shout out our Royal Cloth School of Life family. Y'all, listen. It's some dope teams out there, but I feel like I'm in the dopest team in the whole world. Like this whole building was one color, mint green, spearmint. Yeah, I said it made you want to get a piece of gum and chew it. But listen, we ain't know how we was gonna do it, but we've been coming together every day. About 10, 11 o'clock, Cole's out the eye calling out the next day. I said, listen, I ain't coming today. I don't know what you're going to do. I was at the church putting work on. I was working for God. Huh? Tired, strongholdy, like, I'm hungry. Don't talk to me right now. Like, but I'm gonna paint this trim. You feel me, Marcus? Me and Marcus was about 8:30, Cole painting trim. Like, brother, how many more coats? Like, you know what I'm saying? We painted walls, repainted walls. We did it one way. Matt came in and put his foot down. I ain't know who was the... I said, amen, Matt. Whatever you want to do, your will be done, Matt. Matt, like, nah, I see the whole vision, bro. It gotta be like this. I was like, I don't want no problems. Like, and then y'all know him. If you don't let him do his vision, he gonna be pouting, y'all. We looked around on, what was it, Friday? We like, where Matt at? Like, he like, he won't let me put my TVs up. Bro, you can put your TVs up. Kitty, tell him he can put his TVs up, man. You can do it. Like, but listen, I honor, it's too many of y'all. Y'all gonna get mad if I don't mention what you did, but everything. Listen, we was in here painting and it was all footprints in the paint prints in the sand. I know I say the footprints was in the sand, it was paint prints. Somebody just stepped in all purple and said, la la la, it was footprints everywhere. We came together, we painted, we wiped walls down, wiped floors. I'm saying, I gotta give a shout out to my boy Kenny, praise God, Kenny. Kenny came in like Jesus the carpenter. Don't that stage look good, y'all? And that, listen, he came and put that thing 2.5, right, bro? 2.5. Maybe like 4.5 hours. That's we would say a late night putting it together. But I just thank God for every one of you for your contribution, your time, which you sold, not just the last few days, but over the last few years. We truly could not have done it without you guys, honestly. And it's a group effort, and I just praise God for every one of y'all. Like, God proved this week that it's nothing impossible with him. It's no obstacle we can't overcome. It's no mountain we can't climb. It's unstoppable grace. That's unstoppable grace. Amen? So praise God for all of you. Also, you know, since it's the anniversary, I do want to mention a couple of people that I feel is important to mention. One isn't here. Our brother Jamal. Can we say shout out to Jamal, too? I got to shout him out. Jamal, he's serving overseas right now. We just want to shout him out. We miss him. We love him. I hope you get a chance to see. Amen. I just want to mention a couple of people that me and my wife, we feel is very important to our progress and our process. One of them isn't here. He moved away. And in our earliest stages, he helped start the ministry with us. His name is Brother Joe Smith. If he was here right now, everybody be looking at him crazy because he'd be laying right here with his hands up in the air, worshiping God the whole time. But he was just different like that. He was very peculiar, you know, my brother, but he was a blessing. Amen. And he played a major role, and he gave a big contribution, time, finances, resources, prayer, to help us in that beginning stage of the ministry get going. And whenever his name is mentioned in this ministry, let it be with honor. Amen. Because of the grace that God placed on his life, it was a big contribution to help us get to where we need to be. Amen. So since it's our anniversary, I wanted to also give him a shout out and bless him wherever he is right now. God is using him in an awesome way, but that's one person that whenever his name is mentioned, put some respect on his name. Amen. And the other person I wanted to mention it's a little emotional, but I want to mention this person because without this person, you know, we celebrate this building, but we wouldn't be in this building today without their contributions as well. You know, and for the last couple of years, this person has done whatever they possibly could to help me and my wife advance the ministry. And they truly are a kingdom builder. They truly are a true apostle and a true man of God. I can make a whole laundry list of the things that this person has sacrificed for us to be where we are today. The obvious ones is they allowed us to use their building. I remember when we first met this person, we was in our old building in Cherry Hill, and we ain't had no mics. We was trying to talk as loud as we can so you can hear us. And this man of God donated mics to us and a sound system. And he said, man, whatever you need. I remember saying, brother, I want to do a foot washing. And he came with pans and towels and hands. And he was the first one down washing feet, bringing the glory. Like, he's a true man of God. He's an anointed man of God. I'm greatly appreciative that we were able to know him, and we are able to know him, and the favor that we've had with him. And whenever his name is mentioned in this ministry, let it be with honor. Amen. Because of his contributions. Without his contribution, it's very possible that we would not be here today. Amen. And that person is Apostle Christian Schley. Come on, stand up, Apostle. Come on, stand up. Matter of fact, come on up, man. Come on up. I know. Come on up. Cause, yeah. Come on up. Listen, we got a bunch of rooms now, but when we ain't have no rooms, He made his personal storage available. It's so many things, from giving us resources to giving us space to giving us prayer to dealing with my indecisive behind and supporting me when I ain't know if I wanted to go left or right. And even one of the most memorable things, you know, my journey been hard as a man of God. Everybody wasn't always excited about me being a man of God. And I can count on one hand the people that supported me no matter what, and he's been one of them. You know, through the pandemic, he made sure that holy hands was laid on me and that everyone bear witness to the call of God on my life. And it means a lot. It does. It means a lot. It means a lot. And we want to tell you we do love you, and we appreciate you. We do. Everything that you've ever done for us, we appreciate you, man. We had a cookout at his house. This man cooked all the food. This dude cooked. It was only 20 of us. He cooked 300 pieces of chicken. He said, "Brother, take this chicken." I said, "Brother, I don't know what I'm going to do with this chicken." But I wanted to say that because I wanted to give a practical illustration of when God put it in this man's heart to support you, he'll go above and beyond to do what you need to do. And truly, he's done that for us. So whenever his name is mentioned in his ministry, put some respect on his name. In Jesus' name. We honor you. We appreciate you. This is a small token of our appreciation. We wanted to bless you. I'm doing it in front of everybody, because if I ain't doing it in front of everybody, he wouldn't take it. He wouldn't take it, because he's a servant of God, and he do it out of the love, and he do it on God's behalf. So I got to do it in front of everybody so that he'll take it in Jesus' name. And I don't even listen. I mean, listen, y'all, even to what I got on today, hallelujah. Even to what I got on today, my brother blessed me with this suit for my birthday. Mom hooked me up. She back there. Listen, if y'all want a suit made from the glory, she'll hook you up. So we love your brother. We do. We appreciate you, man. God bless you, man of God. Amen. And that's a small token, man. It's, you know, it's more to come. So we got to figure out a way to put it in his hand where he won't give it back. Amen? In Jesus' name. So without further ado, is it something you want to say? Come on, you go ahead and say something.
I just love all of y'all, and I just want to give honor to my husband. Amen. Because God gave him this in his belly, and it was like, I said, "Babe, let's just go." He said, "I have to submit it." And we had to wait. We couldn't just go and do what God told him that he had to do. He said, "I'm just going to follow the instructions.
Come on now. Come on."
And I'm going to suffer, and I'm going to wait and sit on what God gave me until they tell me I could go. For lack of a better word, babe, I'm so proud of you. Amen.
I'm going to hold it together. I'm going to try to, I'm going to go like this, wipe it. Ah. Amen. Amen. So we love you guys. And without further ado, we're going to get ready for the word. Say, "I'm ready."
I'm ready.
For the word.
For the word.
I'm ready.
I'm ready.
For the word.
For the word.
Hallelujah. Without further ado, we're going to have our speaker, Brother Kenneth Robles, come forth. He's going to bless us with the Hawaiian
hallelujah,
Sophia.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah, I need me one of them suits. I support the people that come in the barbershop like, "Yo, I got polo shirts for sale. I got these nice." I support the hustlers that come in the barbershop. You know, y'all could be seated. Well, praise God. Like 10 hours ago, this place didn't look like this. And, you know, there was sawdust everywhere. this wasn't here, that wasn't there, but people sacrificed their time, so I honor everybody for their hard work. I honor my friends for coming. You know, my brother June, I call these guys brothers because when you friends for so long, y'all can become brothers. Y'all become tighter than brothers, you know. And my boy Free right there, his wife, his family over there, my brother Irv back there, his family, my sister Lydia, whatever she has, she's probably on the floor. Amen. And their family and their mom all the way from Florida. She was encouraged to come to church. And I really honor Lydia because she's like the shepherd of that family. Like she makes sure everybody's straight. That's how I was just back there worshiping with the kids, and I had to take like 10 of them to the bathroom, you know, had to make sure they all were straight. But thank you for coming out today. This is a very special day. You know, I praise God that you sacrificed your morning, your time to come here, but we want to talk about the greater sacrifice that Jesus has made. Amen? Amen. In the beginning of time, God said, let there be light, because the earth was without form and void, and he spoke things into existence, and he said, I will create man in my image, and on the sixth day, he created man, and on the seventh day, he said, I will rest in man. The union between God and man became one. They became married. They became together. But then Adam and Eve, as we are as humans, they kind of messed up. They kind of disobeyed God. They didn't follow his instructions and wanted to follow the flesh. And on that day, it was a separation. Adam said, I feel naked. We must cover ourselves with fig leaves. And there, here's God. Not a God that say, Adam, what have you done? You disobeyed my order. But a God that says, Adam, where are you? I'm looking for you. Adam, Eve, where are you? But here Adam is hiding. He said, sorry, Lord. Adam, why are you covered in fig leaves? Lord, because we were naked. Well, who told you you were naked? Who told you? I never taught you you were naked. But he was separated from God. A separation between man and God, between flesh and spirit, is death. And when I looked at the scripture and I see God calling me all my life, I'm like, God, all my life I have been living in death. They indoctrinate me with lies and death. But here comes God calling me. Kenny, where are you? Kenny, I want to be with you. I desire to be inside of you. You see, God created us to be a temple, a tabernacle that he can live inside of us. But because of sin, we are separated from God and we live in a death. What is death? Death is separation from God. The wages of sin is death. Wages is what you get paid for when you work at your job. You look at your check, your wages. The wages of sin is death. So as you sin, you're getting paid death. You deserve death. It's almost like a barter system. Because of your sin, something has to die. Death. So God gave Moses an instruction. To pay for your sin, something has to die. Death. You must take a lamb and sacrifice the lamb, an unblemished lamb, that he may die, and that blood will cover your sin. So something has to die to pay for your sin. I think about one of the oldest books in the Bible. It's the book of Job. When I first read it, I called it Job. But it's the book of Job, one of the oldest books in the Bible. It's not at the beginning, because in the beginning of the Bible, you have the first five books of Moses. Then you have the Judges, the Kings, and then you have the poetry books, which are Proverbs, Psalms, Song of Solomon, and Job, so on and so forth. But Job, every day he sacrificed a lamb for himself because he didn't want to be separated from God. Every day he sacrificed a lamb for each one of his kids so they won't be separated from God. Something had to die to cover your sin. Abraham, the first Hebrew that was called by God, finally had his promised son. A son that was promised to him, even though he was past 80 years old, he thought he wouldn't have kids. But God said, Abraham, you are a man of faith, and I've been calling you, and you've been walking for me, but I want you to do one thing and one thing for me only. Sacrifice your only promised son. So Abraham obeyed. There was nothing in the world that Abraham loved more than his only son by his wife, Sarah. So he said, come on, Isaac, we're going to sacrifice. We're going to do a sacrifice. We got to go up this mountain and do a sacrifice. Isaac said, Daddy, I see the firewood for the burnt sacrifice. I see the rope to tie the lamb up with. And I see the knife. But Dad, where's the sacrifice? He said, come on, son. The Lord will provide a sacrifice. Something he had to do was so hard. He didn't understand God, but he was ready to sacrifice his own son. How grieved can you be to climb a mountain? A faith to climb a mountain, knowing that you don't know why God told you to climb the mountain, but I'm going to do it because my faith can climb mountains. So Abraham goes on top of the hill, and then he starts tying up his son. Puts the wood underneath him. And as he goes to sacrifice his son, the Lord yells, wait! And he looks, and there was a lamb caught in a bush. And God said, I wanted to see where your faith was at. See, I believe God put human in experience to something that he will experience. Because what Abraham told his son, that God will provide a lamb to cover your sin, is what will happen in the future. But there is a death that must be paid to cover your sin. In the book of Job, Job suffered so much. Most prosperous, most perfect man living on planet Earth. But he lost his business. He lost his house. He lost his family. And Satan said, I could bet you, God, that I could get him to curse you to your face. And Job, the father of integrity, never cursed God. And he said, I know that my Redeemer lives. I know that when I die, it's something greater. That when I go to the pits of Sheol, I will be delivered. You see, there are scriptures in Job where he talked about how God would not leave him. In Job 14:14, he says, if a man die, will he live again? Job knows that death is permanent, and the one, and that once he passes, he will be unable to plead with God that he did nothing wrong. But his sin will keep him endlessly trapped in the grave, because the only currency you can pay for sin is death. The only currency you can pay for sin is death. Money's a currency. You pay for something, in exchange, you get something back. So the only way to pay for your sin is for something has to die. That's the currency. That's why we got instructions to sacrifice the lambs in those times. And Romans 6:23 says, therefore, Job recognized early on that the only possible resolution to sin and its deadly consequences is a resurrection. For this reason, in Job 19:26, he declares with the utmost confidence, even after my skin is destroyed, yet from my flesh I will see God. Job does not know how God is going to do it, but he believes in his heart that somehow God will raise him from the dead. In Job 33:29-30, you see, Job didn't understand why he had to go through, I lost my family, I lost my job, I lost everything. And then you got three of his friends come, bro, you must have did something wrong, bro. God, you must have slipped up somewhere. One of them lambs must have had a spot that you sacrificed, you know, because God wouldn't punish you.
Come on now, Kenny.
He wouldn't punish you for no reason. You must have did something wrong. But as your walk in life, God only allows you to go through. He allows you to go through things to prepare you for something greater. Amen. He allows you to feel pain that you could feel other people's pain. He did it with Abraham. He did it with Hosea. He told Hosea, marry a prostitute. And then she was at another man's house. He said, pay the ransom. Pay everything to get your prostitute wife back, to redeem them. But this payment will not be currency, because the currency to pay for sin is what? Death. Amen. So the fourth friend of Job finally came to him, Elihu, and he said to Job, behold, God does all this oftentimes with men to bring back his soul from the pit, that he may be enlightened with the light of life. Elihu too recognizes that resurrection must be real. Our ending point, that road that ends to death, to a dark place, guess what? There's a light at the end of the road. Because God is preparing to take upon the sins of the whole world to pay for death, that we may be redeemed. In Psalms 91:16 says, with a long life I will satisfy him and let him see my salvation. God promises us to give us a Messiah, a long life, a length of days, forever and ever, for eternity. He promised us to give us a Messiah that will save us from death, to be returned to God to live in eternity. See, some of us don't know how to deal with death sometimes. As for me, I was a smoker, and I didn't know how to cover the pain or cover the agony. So my flesh would tell me, you know what? You're depressed. I'm hearing voices in my head. You're depressed. You need some time off. Let's spend time together. And I felt like if I was to smoke, It'll calm my nerves down. It will calm my anxiety down. It will cover my depression. But then I started to figure out I was a slave to it. I couldn't wake up without it. I couldn't go out without it. I couldn't eat without it. I couldn't enjoy a girl without it. I couldn't go to sleep without it. It's almost like I needed permission from my addiction to even have fun. Then I started to think about, why am I finding peace and comfort in something that came out of the ground? But it was really the demonic voice in my head that was telling me to smoke to find peace. Then I was like, why am I even I listen to you? You are my depression. You are my anxiety. You are the one tricking me to believe that if I smoke, I will be at peace. But it never brought me peace. I tried to cover my death with something that was killing me. I was trying to cover my death with something that was just fig leaves. It was making me hide from God. I'm like, Lord, I don't want to do this. I can hear you calling me, like God has called you today. Some of you people, God has been pulling on your heart today. But it's some things we have to get rid of in order that we can hear his voice clearer. Today is Resurrection Day. Today is a day that Jesus rose from the grave and conquered death. Today can be your resurrection day. Yes. Today you can rise from what's trying to kill you. Today you can rise from what's causing death in your life. Hallelujah. Let's stop trying like being a Christian is corny. Let's stop looking at like loving Jesus is corny. Come on now. Because it's not cool to die. It's not cool to walk around in death. It's not cool when I see somebody I love and I'm trying to talk to them and I could just see a dead man walking. I see a man with dry bones that I try to speak life into him. I want everyone to be risen as Christ risen. He conquered death. So if you feel like something is holding you back today, if you feel like something is trying to separate you from God, today you can give your life to God. He paid for you to be here. See, when I woke up this morning, see, I ain't leave here till like 1 or 2 in the morning. I woke up at 6 something. She was still asleep. I kicked her, you know, like, get up. It's time to go to church. Get up. Get in the shower because I'm jumping in the tank right after you. That was my morning voice. Because once I laid down, I closed my eyes. It was a wrap. I woke up 5 hours later, and this how I know I had a good sleep. Because when I got into the bathroom, I felt a penny unstick itself from my back and fall on the floor. I don't know if y'all ever had a penny stuck to your back, and then you finally, after a couple steps, it hit the floor. And I'm like, man, I must have been out. That's one of them sleeps you just don't move. You just fall and wake up, boom, like, you know what I'm saying? I had this penny stuck to my back, and I feel like God is a God of humor. I like talking to God. I don't even listen to music. I ride in silence, you know, because I like talking to God. I'm like, God, why you let me sleep like that? Got a penny falling out my back like I'm a piggy bank. I'm a broken piggy bank. You know what the Holy Spirit said? He said, I invested in you. I said, God, you funny. What's your name for that one? Jehovah Lapha? trying to make me laugh. I said, God, you funny. So he said, I invested in you. And I want my interest. I invested in you and I want my interest. Not interest, but interested. I want you to be interested in me. I want a relationship with you so bad, I desire to be inside of you. But you're walking around in death, but I made the payment to cover you that we could be one again. That's why you see our family, we breathe in God. God is oxygen. Oh, yeah. Out of my mouth, you will praise me with thanksgiving. That's why we had a long worship. Some of y'all not used to that. They sing for like an hour. They in there jumping, worshiping. My butt hurt on this seat. Y'all got to jump up. You better get up and worship. And loosen your buttocks muscles, then you can sit back down. You know what I'm saying? But that's why we worship. Because we're breathing in God. He invested in us. And we show our interest in him. I breathe in the word and I must give the word. You breathe in a praise, you must give it a praise. You breathe in a dance and you just fill the room full of glory with your dancing and praising and facial expressions and movements and waving. As she waving, I can see just the spirit touching the hearts. God invested in you. He wants to be inside of you. Like that penny that was on my back. I know, it hit the ground hard. I'm like, what? One time, I remember 36 cents fell off my back. I done got in the shower and the hot water melted them all. But God invests in you. He's calling you. And he wants to raise you. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place. A mansion with many rooms. That place is you. He's preparing the room in your heart. He's preparing the room in your mind. He's preparing the room of your eyes, what you see. He's preparing the room of your mouth. He invested in you. You are still here today. You are here for this divine appointment to hear how he has risen, why he has risen, because he wants to raise you from the dead also. And with that being said, I am gladly to announce the apostle of this house to give us a breakdown on how Jesus conquered death, on how Jesus is bringing our salvation, on how Jesus died on a cross 3 days later and rose on this day to save you. So let's give a warm welcome to our apostle Moses.
Amen. Hallelujah. That word was good right there. That was about right there. Amen. Y'all can be seated. Thank you. I appreciate the honor. I feel presidential right now. All the clapping. Hallelujah. But I'm just going to read a scripture to you. I'm going to give you a couple of instructions that the Lord placed in my spirit. I pray that you respond the way he would want you to respond in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're going to do communion. If you open into that, we're going to do communion and we're going to close out today. And you can go eat you some good food on this Easter/Resurrection Sunday. Amen. Praise God. I'm going to read book. This is Acts chapter 2. I'm going to start at verse 22 for those that want to open a Bible. Praise God. It says this. I'm going to read the Amplified version. It says, verse 22, you men of Israel, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man accredited and appointed out and shown forth as commended and attested to you by God, by the mighty works and the power of performing wonders and signs which God worked through him in our midst, as you yourselves know. Somebody say miracle worker. This Jesus, when delivered up according to the definite and fixed purpose and settled plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and put out of the way, killing him by the hands of lawless and wicked men. But God. Amen. But God. Somebody say, but God. You try to kill me, but God. You hated on me, but God. You try to reject me and push me into the corner, but God. You try to slander my name and my reputation, but God. Amen. But God raised him up, liberating him from the pains of death, seeing that it was not possible for him to continue to be controlled or retained by it. For David said in this regard to him, I saw the Lord constantly before me, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken or overthrown or cast down from my secure and happy state. Therefore, my heart rejoiced. Somebody say, my heart rejoiced.
My heart
rejoiced. And my tongue exulted exceedingly. Moreover, my flesh also will dwell in hope, will encamp, pitch its tent, and dwell in hope and anticipation of the resurrection.
Hallelujah.
Say, my heart is going to dwell in hope. Because he lives, I shall live also. Now, it's just something I want to point out about this chapter, this verse. I love it so much. And I'm going to share why I love it. It says something very interesting. It says that God raised him up after they killed him. So they thought that they would put a stop to Jesus' ministry if they kill him. But the thing about the kingdom is it worked different. In the natural, like, you know what I'm saying? When I was growing up in different environments, I had a different mindset. If somebody like was our enemy and we felt they wanted to do harm to us, our mindset is we gonna get them before they get us. Like, we felt like we could stop whatever plan they had against us if we made a plan and stopped their plan. Hallelujah. When I got a little older, we graduated. We would fight and we would jump people. But when we got older, other things started getting involved. It started getting real risky. But in Christ, in the kingdom, it worked different. I don't need that mindset and I don't need that strategy to beat my enemies. Jesus' enemies thought that if they killed him, they'll put a stop to him. But in the kingdom, God set it up a little differently. The thing that the enemy used to kill you, they say it only make you stronger in the kingdom. Like, it only proved that God is a miracle worker. It only proved that God is all powerful. It only proved the sufficiency of God's grace, because what they thought of put an end to you only strengthened you. What they thought of bury you, it only became the ground and the soil in which God will grow your whole ministry. What they thought would stop you only became the platform for God to exalt you and give you a table in the midst of your enemies. That's how I work in the kingdom. Them killing you is all part of the plan. Like, them hating on you is all part of the plan. Them trying to accuse you openly on Facebook is all part of the plan. Don't be mad. It's part of the plan. Let them do it. Like, because the way God worked it, he weaved death to work together for your good. And Jesus is the example of that. They thought they had stopped the plan of God for Jesus' life if they just killed him. They said, we got to stop him. If we don't stop him, he going to have all the power. If he don't stop him, he going to heal all the sick people. If we don't stop him, he going to take away all our influence and our authority. We got to put a stop to this. But they don't know, by killing him, they opened the door for the whole world to be saved. Amen. They ain't know it. The Bible says they ain't know it, because if they would have knew it, they wouldn't have did it. But Jesus knew it. Yeah, I said, that's why Jesus humbled himself and he let him. He said, go and kill me. You know, this is how it's supposed to work. I'm all right with that. God, let him do it. You're going to get the glory from this one. Anybody got a story like that? You said, I ain't going to fight this one. I'm going to let God fight this battle. Like, I ain't even going to say nothing. I ain't even going to say nothing back. Like, they revile me, I ain't going to revile back. They be mad petty on Facebook and throwing indirect shots. I want to. I got a pistol. I could pull it out now. I got a loaded clip. I could pull a loaded clip out now and tell you how I really feel, but I ain't even going to do it. Like, I'm going to let God get the glory from this one. But listen, it says something so interesting that I love. It said God raised them up. But listen. It said he liberated him from the pains of death. Why? It was a revelation, seeing that it was not possible. Somebody say it's not possible. It was not possible for him to continue to be controlled or retained by it. Listen, if Christ is in you, you got something so strong in you, whatever holding you, it only can hold you for so long. You get sick, it only can hold you for so long. You in a trial and tribulation, it only can hold you so long. You get the enemy bring a whole warfare around you, it only can last so long. Because the Bible says that God raised them up because the grave was holding them, but it only can hold them so long. Like, after 3 days, the grave said, hey, God, let this one go. Hallelujah. After 3 days, death said, we got to let this one go. We can't hold them no longer. And I want to declare to somebody that thing can't hold you no longer. If you put your faith in Jesus, that thing that been holding you back, it's going to have to let go. That sickness that been holding you is going to have to let go. Kenny testified of it earlier, that marijuana, it was holding him, but eventually, because he put his faith in Christ, it had to let him go. It said, this one, we can't hold him no longer. God got a greater purpose for him. Amen. First Corinthians 15, verse 12, it says, now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ be not risen, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is also in vain. Yea, we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead is not raised. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain, and you are yet in your sins. But somebody say, the devil is a liar. I wanted to read that scripture because this is why this day is so important. This day is so important to remind us that our faith is not in vain. Jesus dying, giving his life, and resurrecting is a message from God that you have hope for a better tomorrow. It's a message that whatever you're going through, that God can bring you out. It's a message that whatever lifestyle you feel trapped in, that God can bring you out of it. It may not happen the first day. It may not happen the second day. But on the third day. Hallelujah. I'm here to declare to somebody that today is your third day. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. We're going to take communion, and I'm believing that as we take communion, that two things is going to happen. That the same spirit that raised Christ from the grave. You know that nobody ever beat death before. Like, death is the one thing that nobody ever survived. When you die, it's over. You can fall short. You can stumble in your walk with God. You can backslide and you have another chance tomorrow. But after death, there's no more chances. There's no more opportunities. But Jesus, we honor him so well, and he's our greatest champion because he is the only person that survived death. He's the only person that died and lived after death. And because of that, we have hope. If Jesus didn't raise from the grave, then it's no reason for us to have faith. If Jesus didn't raise from the grave, then what are we here doing all of this for? If Jesus didn't raise from the grave, then we all gonna die in our sins and we won't have a better tomorrow. There is no hell for us to go to. It's because of Jesus that I stand here today before you all. Just like my brother, like I was young man, I felt like God had a great purpose for me. I had a purpose, but I didn't know what it was. I didn't know how to find it. I got caught up in this. I hung out with this group, got caught up in this, got caught up in that. Just like many of my brown brothers and sisters, we get caught up hanging with the wrong crowd, doing the wrong things. Some of you know my testimony. I end up getting incarcerated. I didn't get saved in a church. I didn't get saved by a fancy preacher in a suit. I got saved in a cell with three other people in a room with me the size of a bathroom. And I was facing multiple charges and multiple years of my life being wasted away in jail, I came to the realization that it got to be something better for me than this. Like, it has to be a more excellent way. This can't be how my life is supposed to be. I don't want to waste mad years of my life in jail. And in that moment, I said, God, I need you to help me. Like, as a man, I took responsibility for my actions. I said, God, you know, I did the crime, so I'm going to have to do the time, but I don't want to live my life like this anymore. Like, I don't want to stay in this same cycle, you know, trying to cover up the pain, trying to numb the reality of my life with smoking and drinking and sex and all that stuff that we do that we think is fun, like Kenny said, but we really trying to numb the pain of what's really going on in our life. We really trying to numb the pain from the brokenness that we experienced from our childhood. Like, we really trying to numb the pain from the rejection that we felt from our mother or our father or our brothers and sisters or all these different things that we was, you know, we trying to numb the pain from molestation and rapes and stuff that happened to us that robbed us of our innocency. And we just be trying to cope and figure it out. I was just like that. Most of us is just like that. But that's why Christ died. Jesus came to give us life and that more abundantly. Like, he came that all that inner brokenness and darkness and all that stuff that we hold in for all this years, unforgiveness and bitterness. The Bible says that we was dead in trespasses and sins. Like, we thought we was alive, we thought we was lit, but we was really dead. I looked at an old picture of myself when I got locked up. My neck was skinny, all my bones was protruding out of my face. I looked like a skeleton. You could see the darkness on my face, you feel me? You could see the darkness on my face. And I looked at that picture, I'm like, dang, y'all really was dead out here, like. I thought I was lit. I thought I was moving. Thought I was doing my numbers because I had a nice little car, had a nice little outfit. You know what I'm saying? I thought I was clean, but I was dead. I was dirty. When we talk about dead, we're not just talking about the end of your life. We're talking about being separated from God. When a person died, they unaware of everything going out on in the world. When a person is dead, if you touch a dead body, they won't respond to you. They numbed out from everything that's going on. They don't feel anything. So when we living life, but we in a spiritual dead state, it's like we numbed out. Like, I will wake up drinking before I brush my teeth. It could be an old beer that was sitting right there since the day before. I'll wake up and swig it, like, and take the blunt out the ashtray, the leftover, and smoke it. I don't care if it was this big. You know he called it a roach. It'd be this big. I light that last little piece and hit it before I even brush my teeth. You know what I'm saying? Oh, y'all act like y'all don't know what I'm talking about. I'm saying that because I was in a place I was dead, like. I wanted to be numbed out. Like, I wanted to harden myself and disconnect and act like I ain't care about nothing. But the reality is, I did care. I just never knew how to dealt with what I really cared about. Like my dad not being there, like, or not spending more time with my mom, or all these different things that we experience as a child that we never know how to really deal with it, and we just mask it and we be the walking dead. Because we never learn how to heal, and we never learn how to have the real life that God has for us. So we try to find it in a bottle. We try to find it in having mad shorties and all this money and all this stuff that we know we never get satisfied by. It's a lust, because you need more and more and more of it every single time. Like, you be like, man, as soon as I get this couple of dollars, I'm going to be good. And then you get that, and then you need some more, like. You know what I'm saying? You like, man, that one right there, if I get her, ooh, I'm good. I got my eyes on her. Then when you get her, after a month, they ain't, you know, you need something fresh. Okay, now act like y'all know what I'm talking about. Because it's a lust. It never really give you the full satisfaction that they was never intended to give you. Only Jesus was intended to give it to you. Only God can fulfill that void in your heart. Only he can bring the real healing that you need. Only Christ, that's it. He is the one that God has anointed to heal your broken heart. He is the one that God has anointed to deliver you from your sins. He is the one that God has anointed to deliver you from your strongholds. I never seen a dead person get themselves out the grave. I never seen them just break open the casket like, bow, I'm back. Like, so if we dead in trespasses and sins, how you going to get yourself out of that? You need Jesus to get you out. He the only one. He the only one. No apostle, no prophet, no nobody, no preacher, no slick silver tongue preacher that you see on TV. Not even me. It's only one person that can do it for you, and that's Jesus. That's it. That's it. Dead, it means to be ineffective, unable to perform functions, or powerlessness. If it's someone here dead today, the resurrection power of Jesus is made available to you. The other thing that I'm believing God for when we take the communion, when I looked up the definition of death, this is going to be on a different note. It says the permanent ending of a vital process. For some of us, it's a different type of death, because you're going to die to an old season. It's a permanent ending to a vital process. We praise God for that process, but that process is over. Like, we praise God for that season, but that season is over. The Bible says these all died in faith because they embraced the new reality. And for some people today, the resurrection power is for you being raised into a new season, into a new faith, into a new anointing. I don't know whatever God have for you, whatever he been speaking to you in secret, whatever dream God gave you, and you feel like you started feeling like it's unattainable. The Bible said if Christ didn't raise from the dead, then our faith is in vain. God didn't give you that dream in vain. God didn't show you that vision in vain. God didn't give you that idea in vain. And You may have let it die in your heart, but I'm believing God for it to be resurrected in your spirit. I'm believing for the faith that you used to have in God to do miracles to be resurrected in you. I'm believing for the faith and the confidence that you used to have in yourself to be resurrected in you. God wants you to have faith in him, but he wants you to also have confidence in yourself in him as well. You can do all things through Christ that strengthens you. So if it's anyone here, I'll start with this. If it's anyone here that doesn't know Christ, if it's anybody here that your relationship with Christ is estranged and you're in a backslidden state, you used to know the Lord, you used to walk with the Lord, and you want to be restored back to that relationship with him, you have that opportunity. We start there. If you don't know Jesus and you want to get to know Jesus, you can give yourself, you can give your life to Jesus today. Repeat after me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life. Have your way in my heart. Be my healing today and my deliverance. I put my faith and my expectation in you, Jesus, because I can't do it. They did me wrong, but I forgive them. I make a choice today to let it go. It's been holding me all this time, but I don't want it to hold me any longer. So, Father God, today be my freedom. Be my cleansing. Be my healing. Be my strength. Be my provision. Be my joy. And be my peace. You can pass out the communion now. The Bible says that when we take the communion, we do this as often as we do it in remembrance in him, of him. If you don't want to take it, you don't have to. As often as we do this in remembrance of him. So when we take this, we take it in remembrance that he suffered and died on our behalf, that the life of his spirit can remain in us. The bread part is his body that was broken for us. Jesus gave all he had so that you can be resurrected from a place of a coffin. You know, it's so funny, when I was locked up, that's what God told me. He said, you Lazarus, and this is your tomb. But when you come out of here, I'm going to raise you to new life. When you come out of this grave, just like Lazarus, you're going to take these grave clothes off, and I'm going to put new clothes on you, and you will never be the same. So as we take this in remembrance that Jesus is the only way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father but by him. And we take this in appreciation of the sacrifice that he made for us to have a relationship with the Father. Does everybody have one? A little plastic. You know what I'm saying? Work it. This is my body that was broken for me. As often as you eat, do it in remembrance of me. take and eat. We take the grape juice to symbolize the blood of Jesus that was shed on our behalf. And in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, it says that this blood is the new. The Bible says that the blood is the life of the flesh. So we drink this in remembrance that Jesus shed his blood so that we might have the life of God living on the inside of us. But as we take this, we believe in that the life of God's Spirit will resurrect us from anything that's been holding us back, been holding us down, any sin or weight that does so easily beset you. An old season, an old mindset. We drinking this to be raised to new life in Jesus' name. Drink, everyone. Tastes different when they knew. Hallelujah. I just want to pray for everyone that's taking the communion. If you can, just close your eyes. Lift your hands. We lift our hands to position ourselves to receive whatever God will pour out. Father, in Jesus' name, God, we thank you for everything that you have done for us, Lord. We thank you for the life of Jesus. We thank you for the ministry of Jesus. We thank you for the miracle-working power of Jesus. But today, God, we celebrate the resurrection power of Jesus. And Father, for all those that have taken the communion by faith and received this word by faith, I pray that the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead will now begin to work in their mortal bodies, God. That a fresh anointing will come upon them, God, of healing, of deliverance, of freedom, God. That you will begin the work of salvation on the inside of them, God. That the manifold graces of God will begin to work in them and on their behalf, God. That they will have the life that you died for them to have. In Jesus' name, I speak deliverance, I speak healing, and I speak freedom and peace over every person here. In Jesus' name, amen. You dismiss. God bless you all. Just to see you.
just to see.